Paul Reichers.
Ben's going to get us on base.
Don't know, sure.
He's going to get us on base quicker.
The one standing up.
She's the one always talking.
Much better.
She's the one always talking.
Always talking.
Everybody here, yeah, no.
We'll have something to say.
President, we'll get out back. You leave here at 12. We'll be eating lunch.
Say a little bit about her.
45.
Just give an update on what they've done. How
much it is to play? Thank you.
It's a piece of work. I had half her energy.
You have more expensive governor like 10 years ago.
They're Wednesday.
But what'll happen?
This clip still have a little bit. No telling what they might.
Just don't start drooling. Better than the pain, though.
And I told him, I didn't want any pain, buddy. He was popping
it in there.
Everybody's reading the clock, I guess, getting ready. Call this meeting of the Columbia County Board of Commissioners order for this Tuesday, October the 4th, 2016. This time we'd like to President Vice Chair Allen offer up our invocation.
Thank you, sir. Everyone, please bow your heads. Dear Heavenly Father, we come before you this evening. We ask for your blessings upon the proceedings here tonight, that our thoughts and actions, our words and deeds, good in your sight, they execute your will for the betterment of the people of Columbia County. We ask that you look over those that look over us, the first responders, the men and women of our armed forces, protect our lives, our property, and our freedom. We ask that you accept our gracious thanks for all the many blessings you've given us, including the privilege of living in this great free nation, this beautiful state, wonderful community. We ask these things in your name.
Thank you, sir. Would you please stand for the Pledge of Allegiance?
I pledge allegiance to the flag of the United States of America, to the republic for which it stands, one nation, God, indivisible, liberty, and justice for all.
We do have a quorum with all five commissioners present tonight. We have two items of approval for as the minutes are concerned. The first being our commission meeting of September the 20th. If you're satisfied with their content, we'll accept a motion for their approval.
So moved.
Second.
Any discussion? All in favor, please raise your right hand. The next one is our work session concerning the general obligation bond of September the 26th, 2016. Also, if you're satisfied with their content, we'll have a motion for their approval.
So moved.
Second.
Discussion? All in favor, raise your right hand. Thank you. Mr. Johnson, I believe we have one added item from the previously published agenda, or maybe two.
I just have one, Mr. Chairman, for your consideration. Would be the Horizon Industrial Park release document that would be under legal under item J1. I believe the other items have already been modified on the agenda, and it's ready to go as presented.
Okay. Well, welcome each other to this meeting of the commission. And remind you once again that these proceedings are videotaped. If you'd like a copy of the disc, you may obtain one through a request through Ms. Crawley here. All you 4-H'ers might want to see yourself on TV. Miss Shirley, she's all been on so much, it doesn't matter much to her, but we're glad you're all here. Mind you, too, that you're invited to speak to this body. If you're not already on the agenda, we ask that you fill out a speaker form in the back and bring it up to our clerk here, and we'll recognize you at the proper time during the meeting. We do have some presentations. We have a request from Mr. Larry Rogers concerning amending the noise ordinance time. Mr. Rogers, are you with us? Yes, sir. Come forward. Give us your name and address, please.
Thank you, Chairman Cross, for inviting me here. My name is Larry Rogers, 517 Arlington Court in the Halifax North. I've been living in Columbia County for 10 years, and pleasure. The subdivision I live in is a very quiet place, and my neighbors have been nothing gracious, and I love them to death. But recently we had a move-in of a new person across from myself, and I'm having some trouble with the noise. She has decided that she's going to turn her garage into a party place. And one evening, 30, I'd already retired. I hear noise through my window. I went over and I said, "You can't play this music and disturbing me." Response was, "I bought the house and I can do what I want." And she even cited the ordinance, which I was ignorant of. Ordinance that Columbia County has specifically states a time limit of 11 p.m. to 7 a.m. Section 2 ordinance, which gives her leeway, does have an argument, play her music at that time period. I have recorded no less than 4 disturbances during those hours and after those hours. One at 1:50 a.m. Several during the evening. My problem is that I believe that the 11 p.m. to 7 a.m. ordinance restriction is too lenient. Allows for this individual and any individual to disturb the peace. And I've come up with a proposal. I have and if you'll excuse me, I've made 5. Anna and the Albany. Both of those on there, they're excerpts. An outline and an understanding of what DB. Albany ordinance. I prefer the Savannah ordinance, the section that you see. Let me see. This would be section B of the Savannah ordinance, which does not give a specific DB level, so you do not have to worry with firm or firm that they're below that level. But I do think that some type of ordinance. I put an example in the last page, of course, my own words, that could be inserted in section 2, placing the last sentence of that section, what I've written there.
You have additional information?
Other than the information of the dates that I have of the district.
Don't we already have an excessive noise provision in our ordinance, Chris?
We do.
Excessive noise ordinance, of course, right here. This is the ordinance of 2012. And you have the violations in section 1, but you had the enumerations in section. Now, she does have an argument. Limitation on there. She could argue the fact that, yes, I'm making these noises, but I'm not making these noises between hours. I don't know about anybody else, but I like to retire about 10 o'clock, sometimes earlier. I'm getting up in years. And if you have someone that has that party mentality, had this music playing, not going to sleep very well. The whole point of a nice place, your home, have the serenity and the quiet.
And what is the excessive noise portion?
So just to point this out, under our code, the 11 p.m. is just to set what's called a prima facie case against the person. It doesn't mean that you can't also have a case if it's excessive for before then, which I think has worked well in the county in the past to have that flexibility, and I think it's appropriate to have that in there. But essentially, it's, again, if it's before 11 o'clock, it's still possible to have a noise ordinance violation. After 11, it just makes the case more clear for a court of law.
You can still have a deputy come out about excessive noise prior to 11 o'clock?
Correct.
Have you called any of the law enforcement?
I haven't yet because I want to speak with you. I want to be a neighbor first. I'm afraid that it's going to escalate. We're looking at a dozen times a month. I'm going to continue. If I have to continue to call law enforcement, and she's going to make the argument, not breaking the ordinance. It's clear. It's very clear here. Regardless of saying they've disturbed a peace, it's written 11 p.m. Guarantee you, I'm going to use it because they already know it.
You did it at 1:50 a.m., correct?
No, that was the one that woke me up at that time.
But she can still be cited for excessive noise.
That's
prior
right.
to 11 o'clock, can't you?
That's correct. She can, and there's other factors that are considered, like whether it's residential, which would apply here, whether it's recurrent, which would apply here. So there are possibilities that the sheriff could look into determining whether or not this meets a violation.
I would think that maybe back into the wording, try to eliminate the ambiguity here. Date in time. Someone will argue that point in a court of law. Time frame. Look at it and say there's no ambiguity about 11 p.m.
I would assume unless she's a lawyer, she doesn't want to go to court to argue, spend the money to argue playing her music loud.
Maybe so, but I'm the one that have to suffer the slings and arrows until that time period.
We meet every week to discuss ordinances. We can look at this one and see if it's something that we should change the hours on.
Thank you very much for your time. I really do appreciate it.
Thank you, sir.
Thank you, Mr. Rogers.
Thank you.
Next we have in favor of rezoning of 113 South Old Bel Air Road, your item I2C1, Mr. Bobby Maybaum.
Bobby Maybaum, 1008 Meg Street, Augusta, Georgia, 30904. I'm here representing the applicant and the owner of a piece of property located at the corner of Columbia Road and 113 South Old Bel Air Road. We're requesting that the corner itself, which is 2 acres, be rezoned for C2. It is a 10-acre tract. As you know, we presented before doing a planned unit development, and we've gone back now and reduced what we're asking for just 4 to 2 acres, and the remaining 8 acres would remain R1 around this corner. The corner itself, in most people's opinion, now has no residential use, or if any, very limited residential use. It is on R1 right now, but the frontage on Columbia Road with the new improvements to Columbia Road, you have 5 lanes in front of this corner, plus a D-cell lane. And then on Old South Bel Air Road, you have a major intersection with turn lanes and islands. So it's very restrictive on this corner to be a residential property on the corner with these type road conditions. Also, the opposite corner, directly opposite, now you have C2 zoning and you have CC zoning, and with townhouses behind that. So this change is not unique to the area. There's already commercial zoning at this corner. Also, I want to point out this is not a speculative zoning request. The applicant has produced a conceptual site plan and conceptual building elevations, and he fully intends to move forward as soon as possible on the property. And the applicant would continue to own he's buying the whole tract, the 10 acres, so he'll own the 8 acres surrounding the 2 acres. I think all the commissioners a elevation and a site plan. If anybody didn't get it, I've got additional ones. But I guess the last point I want to make, I think the main, if any objections I've heard, the objection would be that this corner was not designated in the new 2035 conceptual plan for spot zoning, and that is understandable, but also you already have C2 and CC on the other corner, so why it was not looked at as a potential commercial growth, I'm not sure what was taken into account. But I think we'll all agree that as the county changes infrastructure improvements and demographics changes, there are going to be required modifications to this 2035 plan. And all we're asking is look at it on the merit. If the merit is right and it should be done, it shouldn't matter if it's done today or if it's done 2 years from now. If it's what should happen at this particular site, that's what we think should happen. So any questions, I'll be happy to answer.
Do you have any idea what will go in the, it looks like you're going to have a second building or second use in this building?
Their intention and hopefully is some type of restaurant attached on the side of a building. And we do not have a tenant as speak today, but that is the intention, is to have some type of restaurant going in the property in the same building.
You're going to stay around until we get to this item. Any questions?
Yeah.
Okay. Now we get to do some fun stuff, a proclamation for Georgia 4-H Week, presented by Commissioner Richardson and the 2-hour 4-H County Council Executive Board. It's Shirley Williamson and her group. Y'all can come on forward.
Good evening, County Commissioners and Chair, County Representatives, and community. I am George Wurst, a junior at Harlem High School, and 2017 District Northeast District Board President. UGA Extension is a county, state, federal, county, state, and federal funded organization extending lifelong learning in Georgia through unbiased research-based education. UGA Extension helps Georgians become healthier, more productive, financially independent, and environmentally responsible in 4-H and youth, agriculture, the environment, communities, and families. Winning multiple awards at district and state levels, Columbia County 4-H is one of the most outstanding programs in the state.
I'm Vienna Elmgreen, a 4-H County Council member, a junior at Evans High School, and one of the 3,000 4-H'ers in Columbia County. Extension 4-H staff and volunteers conduct 100 meetings each month, and 5 volunteers lead specialty clubs while supervising additional volunteers. The Modified Trap Target Sporting Club has over 100 members and 18 safe certified coaches. The coaches and staff want to thank Columbia County for the use of their practice site at the decommissioned landfill. With the majority of 4-H'ers living in living in areas with a covenant prohibiting livestock, the equestrian club gives 4-H'ers without a horse an opportunity to learn riding skills, visit stables, and to study equestrian conformation and to go on.
I am Sam Basso, County Council Vice President and Archer. This year, we have over 45 new and returning members into the program. Not everyone can be a Katniss Everdeen, but our members practice for JOAD, USA Archery, and 4-H competitions every year. I wanted to be in the Rabbit Club as well as the Archery Club, but my mother and my cats said that's not going to happen. But these members select a pedigree animal, learn responsibility and care, and have the opportunity to show and their animal and shows and all around the CSRA.
I am Julianne Jones, a junior at Evans High School and a Columbia County 4-H Council President. I am in charge of the mechanics, and I am one of the co-captains for our first robotics competition team. The team raised more than $15,000 to participate in competitions thanks to state at University of Georgia this past year. 4-H is proud to offer opportunities in service, leadership, and public speaking. By participating in Project Achievement, 4-H'ers learn how to present a demonstration and how to become a better public speaker.
Mm-hmm. 4-H'ers from all over the state auditioned for a chance to be a part of the prestigious performing arts group, Clovers and Company. I am Emma Wurst, a freshman at Harlem High School, 2016 Junior Board President, and enjoy hearing Clovers anytime I get the chance. Winning at the district event advances a high school 4-H'er to state congress in Atlanta. A first place win here earns the master 4-H status. Julianne Jones and Harley Williams now claim that honor.
I am Carter Sellers from Stallings Island Middle School. I was so excited when I was elected as 2017 Northeast Junior Board member. It was a little heart-stopping to present my campaign in front of over 400 middle school students. My brother Kyle is a state 4-H board member. George, in the middle, is the district board president. Each year, Columbia County 4-H takes one of the largest delegations to 4-H camp. Rock Eagle was so much fun last year, and we are looking forward to attending Camp Jekyll 4-H Center.
Sure, it's that one. Ron Cross is in that one. I had to put on my glasses. Jeff.
He was not only in that one, he was in about 100 others.
Well, we can leave it up. I'm proud to share that according to a Tufts University study, Georgia 4-H has more than two times, Georgia 4-Hers are two times more likely to contribute to their communities than any other than youth not in 4-H, three times more physically active than youth not in 4-H, five times more likely to graduate from college than youth not in 4-H, and two times more likely to pursue careers in science not in 4-H.
Thank you for your time and commitment. Help Columbia County make the best better.
Well, everyone knows what a great job Shirley does with 4-H. Commissioner Morris and I have had the privilege of going to a lot of their banquets and seeing all these young people with their activities, and you do a great job, and we hope we've got you a facility out there that's satisfactory, at least for a while now.
Probably.
Well, you should be, since the county's growing too. But again, thank all of you for all that you do in 4-H. It's really impressive. We have a request from Jim Bartley to speak about about fees.
I'm Jim Marley, and I live at 1111 Spotswood Drive in Evans. And I had talked to Gary and Doug about the fee increase for the inspection department. Is that correct? Y'all gonna vote on that tonight?
Yes.
That's okay.
Well, I think it's a fee reduction, isn't it?
What did you say?
It's not a fee increase. I think it's a fee reduction.
Reduction.
Yeah, well, I mean, it was a fee increase before, and that's coming. It's coming back to a point, but it's increased from where it was previously, you know. And only thing I'd like to say is I'm the one who cleaned up the inspection department back in 2000. None of y'all were around. You weren't here. Blisky was. And I had to count for every dime that was over there, like the law said, and everything. All the way down, I went all the way down through the paper that was bought in that place. And Sobliski thought that department never made a dime. But Atlanta sued, got $5 million for collecting more than what it cost to run the department. And one thing in this law changed. Hadn't been rewritten because Joey Brush was one of the main ones involved in writing this legislation. That's how far it goes back. Savannah sued. They owed the builders back $1 million. I think it was Macon was the other one. You're going down this road, you lose too, because the case law's there. And Blisky threw his hands up out in the parking lot to me and said, "You win. We're not going down there." We had a lawsuit filed in Richmond County. They threw their hands up. "We're not going down this road. We ain't gonna fight you. It's your department. Y'all work it out." Blisky sat out in that parking lot and said, "But you'll give it back because that thing had never made a dime ever. It's a loser." $850,000 later in the reserve fund, well, it makes money, and we accounted for it until y'all did away with the Construction Advisory Board. I wouldn't be here if we had the Construction Advisory Board that met here, because everybody, plumbers, electricians, heating, everybody was in here able to say whatever we wanted to and work stuff out, then they recommended to y'all. But y'all so fit to get rid of it. We have these problems in Richmond County. They have the same identical thing we set up back then in place. Discuss, do, don't have anything adversarial down there at all. They'll work with anybody on anything. You'd never have a problem down there. And I'm building a house down there. You only have the adversarial up here. And y'all had the little meeting with Mark Ivey and a couple other people. That's home builders. Home builders does not represent, they represent less than 10%. And that's a special interest group, dues paying organization. 10% of the licensed contractors in Columbia County. I'm talking about heating and air, plumbers, electricians, residents that pull the permits. It's illegal to meet with a special interest group and no one else. And you had a private meeting. Nobody else was there representing the contractors who are not paying dues to the Home Builder Association. Won't make it in a court. Not hardly. I'll get to you in just a minute. But I'm just saying, I'd like for y'all to, you know, just look at yourselves. What have y'all done? What one thing have y'all done with our inspection department since you've been elected, where we gave it to you. We had it run up. The Construction Advisory Board did a good job. We had Richard Harmon. We had inspectors. They never had a turnover. The reason we had the $850,000 built up, we voted, recommended y'all to move it from $500 up higher. So we had it so inspectors never had to worry about losing their job. If everything went to the devil, which it has, and it doesn't use one dime of taxpayer money to run it. Y'all done away with the Construction Advisory Board. You did away with the workman's comp. We got dead framers. You got a building burned down. What have y'all done? You've done nothing but tear it down. We're a laughing stock in the state of Georgia now. As much as I like Paul Scarberry, he's still not a licensed, he's still not a certified building official. He was going to get the test real quickly after he got the job. How long has he been here? And I mean, I like him. Don't get a fine Christian person. Still ain't certified. Now, Miss Ash, look at y'all. You're taking the fees up. You've took them up. I waited for you to pull them back and see that you were doing wrong, but you're going to still keep them up higher. You ain't done anything but tear it down. And I remind y'all, both of y'all, one thing on the law. Remember when I had the lawsuit going over there in Highgrove, and then we had the sediment traps over there that weren't removed. And I told y'all, man, they've done an NOI, an NOT, notice of termination. Talked to you, Scott. Said, you know, they're supposed to take these sediment traps out. You said, sent me an email on it, said, if you can show me in the law, because the county attorney says, we accepted the NOT. There's nothing we can do to make them take these sediment traps out. We made a mistake. We should have caught it. You can show me in the law where we can go back and make the developer take them out. We'll do it. What did I do? Put you in the law. They took them out, didn't they? The EPD met out there. Self-regulating. Got to do it. Not going to be wrong on this one either. Now, y'all excluded everybody. I get Bob Lowe. Get in, you know, move to get injunction, put it back in account for it all, it open to everybody. I'll win. Basically, the same thing that Grovetown did over there on that one, and the judge already ruled. Got to be accountable, and you just can't take them up. I hope you don't go down that road. I hope you'll sit here and discuss this stuff, go back over these things and find out why. How can you go from the fees, nothing's changed. You ain't got any more people over there. I'm talking about inspectors. I'm talking about inspectors, a building official, has to run that department. You ain't added, you have not got any more things. And we amassed $850,000, and now you need to go up. The law says you can't go up unless you account for it. I know you can sit here and try to cook the books. Sit here and do anything until I go through them with a CPA sitting beside me. And you know that's what Judge is going to say. Y'all get together, work it out. Let's try to amicably work this out. That's all I'm saying. Sit down, work it out. The other people who do it, other than a hand-picked select group of special interest people. Thank you all for your time.
We go now to our consent agenda. These are items that's been to the proper committee and got the necessary three votes to be put on consent. Take all of these items as one vote if you so desire.
So moved.
Second.
Any items needing any discussion? All in favor, please raise your right hand. Okay. Go now to our debate agenda. We move to our vice chair, Trey Allen.
Sir, under unfinished business, development and engineering services, ordinance number 60. I'm sorry, I make a motion to approve the second and final reading of Ordinance 1631 to amend Article 2 of Chapter 34, amending the declaration of nuisances, abatement process for nuisance, and the associated violations and penalties for them.
Second.
I believe this is still in our desire to comply with the state law as written.
Correct.
Any further discussion? All in favor? Next item.
I'd like to make a motion to approve the second and final reading of Resolution 16-1250, amending the development services fee.
Second.
Any discussion?
This will bring this to 18. That's square foot up, like bringing it down.
That's correct.
Yes. After the, I guess, reaccounting of where the balance and what the fees were doing. Further discussion? All in favor?
Under Development and Engineering Services, I would like to make a motion to approve the request to rezone a 2-acre portion of a 2-acre portion located at 113 South Old Bel Air Road from R1 to C2.
Second.
This is in contrast to what planning and zoning, what staff recommended. Andrew, would you give us a little reasoning behind the disapproval from both staff and planning and zoning?
As mentioned before, this portion of the county isn't within a dedicated activity center by plan. Staff felt like this was, in essence, flying in the face of that plan. Hasn't developed as commercial all these years.
Mr. Maybaum made the point that nobody's going to want to build a house on that corner. How do you feel with that statement?
There's a lot of residential development around it. Interesting fact that a bunch of residential development in that area counters that.
But that residential development could carry on back behind this parcel of land, correct?
It could.
So the only reason to have that as residential, would it be for a driveway into a community? You wouldn't need that since you got a road there, would you?
I mean, you could absolutely have some residential development. Adequate buffering around it. Character of what's out there already. Without having additional.
But there is some commercial across the road already.
There's some undeveloped commercial land owned at vacant.
And as I've looked at the plat, I don't see much else done with that corner.
No, so Mr. Chairman, I think that we have a very good plan with the 2035 plan, and I appreciate all the work that the staff has done in developing it. And I think that this is a residential corridor destined to be, but every once in a while you get an anomaly, and I really just do not see a problem with the small 2-acre parcel on the corner of this particular lot with the traffic, in my opinion, on a 5-lane highway with a major artery abutting it on the side, and allowing a service station, convenience store operation to be constructed there, as long as it's tasteful and in character of the neighborhood.
Any additional comments?
Wasn't there something in the narrative about a different commercial zone, not necessarily a C2 or?
Yeah, parcel across the street, across South Old Bel Air Road, has a mixture of basically a go on zoning and C2. It's really no different than a C2.
It restricts it a little bit from some certain uses, is that correct?
It does.
But the convenience store would still be allowed in CC?
I believe if it were CC, we worked out that the convenience store would not be allowed.
Would not be allowed.
Storage, possibly the UST issue, or the underground storage tank issue, possibly, or would that be the deciding factor?
Intensive, higher intensity.
Okay. The traffic price count and all that. Okay.
And this is not speculative, right? Mr. Maybaum, he is going to, if he gets his rezoning, he is going to start.
But if this is rezoned to C2, you really don't have to build the service station. You can build anything under C2. It's not specific to that service station. Any further questions? We have a motion to approve. All in favor, please raise your right hand. This is unanimous then.
With the conditions enumerated what?
I
plan,
didn't.
In plan, there were
actually
some
did not
commissions.
Read that in the motion, but can we?
Whatever you want to do.
Can we amend that? I mean, we can amend that motion to but these plans were not officially entered into the record.
You can make a motion to recall that motion. We can do that, can't we, Chris? New motion.
So it would be a motion or.
You got to the next meeting to change your vote on a motion.
That's right. I think it'd be a motion to reconsider.
You'd like to make a motion to reconsider?
Sure.
There were a couple of conditions in there.
I'll make that
if
motion.
We move forward.
The one condition that was listed by staff as a landscaping condition, developer must keep all trees, caliper, or
enumerated.
Health within the required landscape.
Conditions enumerated and according to plan.
Y'all need a vote on the motion.
Let's stay in order here, Drew. We need a motion to reconsider.
I made that motion.
When?
Second.
Just a couple seconds ago before Gary asked his question.
Well, we're getting out of line here.
I'm
we
sorry.
Need to be able to
there is a motion to reconsider on the floor, and there is a second from Mr.
Any further discussion? All in favor of the motion to reconsider? All right. Now the floor is open for your motion.
I would now like to make a motion to approve the request to rezone a 2-acre portion of the land of the lot located at 113 South Old Bel Air Road from R1 to C2 with conditions enumerated in the planning meeting and according to plans provided at this meeting of the Board of Commissioners.
Does that take into account?
Wait, are we going to get a second or not?
All right, yes.
Second.
All right, now we got discussion.
Is that satisfactory, Clerk? With plans provided at this meeting, Board of Commissioners?
Well, it sounds to me that you're saying that you're going to restrict him only to the site plan that he has by doing it that way. Is that the intent of the motion to do that, to only be the store that he has presented? Because if you add that condition in there, then that's all it can build. I'm not sure that we can do a conditional zoning like that.
What I'm trying to do is give him enough leeway to complete the construction, obviously, but to keep the proposed usage of a convenience store based on the plan available that's been presented.
In essence, you want it to remain a service station?
Yes, sir, in general. But they don't call them that anymore.
A convenience store?
I guess.
As long as they don't have a massage parlor in the back.
Easy.
That is against any part of this motion that is on the floor.
Warm up here.
So, I mean, with respect to council and staff, is that according to plans provided at this Board of Commissioners, at this meeting of the Board of Commissioners? Now, will that give leeway to him through the staff of planning to...
So, if you're trying to be flexible but get your point across, I would say, you know, that you'd want a motion to limit the use to a convenience store.
Okay.
And a plan to be agreed upon with the planning
with
staff.
Planning staff. All right. So I would like to make an amendment to my motion.
Do we have to vote on that?
No, he's going to amend it before we vote.
I'm going to amend it. So I would like to amend that rather than saying according to plans provided to the Board of Commissioners to limit the usage to that of a convenience store and plans agreed to between the owner, the developer, and staff.
Right. We have a second to the amendment.
Are you voting to second?
Doug, please. Let's try to stay with the protocol. Do we have a motion, a second to the motion to amend his motion?
I'm trying to keep up with what the protocol is, sir. Second.
You do a motion, then you do a second, and then you discuss and ask questions. Now, ask your question.
Bobby, you raised your hand.
Do you agree with the amendment?
That that's why we have the flexibility in the site plan. Yep. So the new motion should cover your concerns.
As long as the use is what you've presented to us tonight, you're fine. The site plan can be amended at any time, as long as the use remains the same.
So can the appearance of the building, if it'll pass the
correct
the plan review.
Which it would have to do anyways.
Yeah.
Under any circumstances.
We have an amended motion on the floor. All in favor, please raise your right hand. So that makes the original motion mute. Next item.
Yes, sir. I'd like to make a motion to approve the request to rezone 417 Lewiston Road from R1 to C2 for a proposed fast food service subject to the conditions enumerated in the September 15, 2016 Planning Commission report.
Second.
So I believe it's near Kroger and it's a Dunkin' Donuts and a proposed retail center.
Correct.
Any further discussion?
I just wanted to point out this is a very interesting design with the bridge layout of the two nearly parallel roads, giving the frontage due to the coming expansion of Lewiston, correct? Isn't that why we did it this way?
I did not follow that at all. I'm sorry.
That's one of the conditions to get the right of way for the new road.
Right.
Right.
That's it.
Thank you for the clarification.
Any further discussion? All in favor?
I would like to make a motion to approve the request for variances to Section 90-140 Landscaping and Section 34-1 Tree Management for 233 John Deere Parkway, currently zoned M2, to reduce the required tree density to 245 caliper inches and submit an alternative landscape plan. And, an addendum, I would like to make a motion to deny the request to waive the application fee.
Second.
This is the new warehouse, and it concerns security operations and the fact that they're a foreign trade zone.
That's correct. Andrew, myself, our landscape architect, we walked the site. They pointed out a lot of the federal regulations they have to abide by to be a foreign trade zone, and our code just required too many trees. Their cameras couldn't see the entire site, so they asked for this variance.
Another discussion?
Who's asking for the request to waive the application? The applicant?
Correct.
Is it John Deere?
No, this is next to
the house owner.
Different call back.
Okay. Other discussion? All in favor?
I would like to make a motion to approve Resolution 16-1251, adopting the Uchi Creek Greenway Implementation Plan.
Second.
And I believe this addresses a few items of the cost estimate and what other two or three things was in there.
Yes, sir. This is a revised routing for the UG Creek. The route was 18 and a half miles. This is a mile plan. Both off street. For all cost estimate being.
Still $800,000 a mile out, isn't it?
Right.
Further discussion? All in favor? Does that do your portion?
Yes, sir. Now it goes to Mr. Richardson.
I've got it goes to Commissioner Morris. Where do we go?
Mr. Morris is himself on this one.
You've got the water item.
I make a motion to approve the engineering proposal with Zell Engineering for the Morningside and Flowing Wells tank sites water handling for $39,500.
Second.
Any discussion of this item? All in favor? We have one preclusion, I guess, from Mr. Morris because you have an interest in this. Okay. Please note that in the minutes. Commissioner Duncan?
Yes, sir, Mr. Chairman. I make a motion to approve the Horizon Industrial Park release.
Second.
Our economic director, Robbie Bennett, here, and I believe this allows us to pursue other industrial parks without being in with a particular developer. And I guess lets them off the hook on some things that's not been sold yet, and maybe some that is sold. Requested by the Development Authority, of course. Okay. Further discussion? All in favor? Do we have any additional requests to speak? Do we have any comments from the commission?
I don't want to get in trouble. I'm just going to. Here.
Well, it's not really rocket science, you know.
That's why I'm struggling.
Oh, too simple. You're like Einstein.
Right, you can't do the little stuff. You're quick.
We do have a item under executive session. Couldn't decide if it's litigation or real estate, but we'll find out when we get in there. So this time we'll take a motion to adjourn briefly to executive session.
So move.
Second.
All in favor? We are briefly adjourned. We're not having...
That gentleman gave us about found ordinance.
To call a meeting back to order. Mr. Driver, would you give us an update on our executive session, please, sir?
Yes, although I believe there's a couple ways you could categorize this. I say it's most properly a property matter, and there was no action taken in the executive session.
I'd like to thank our survivors that remained in here, Andrew and Angela and Jan. The only ones that's not a captive audience here. Any other business to come before this?
Andrew, we'll give you a bottle of water for staying.
He just woke up.
Well, Andrew, I meant you could add liberty to leave, but you didn't, so.
I make a motion, will you adjourn?
I'll second that.
All in favor? We be adjourned.
Can I make a motion to reconsider that motion?
Would you like to amend that motion anyway?